address in Gaya. I'm basically working on system of root intensification method of crop cultivation. And I scaled this up to lakhs of families.
I'm Dr. Athani, representing Graam Chetana farmers producer organization. In fact, we are an NGO, Future Roots, and we are working in four verticals. And each vertical is represented by farmers producers organization, and Graam Chetana is one of them. So in Graam Chetana, we work from seed to consumer concept, trying to link the entire value chain from the ground to the consumer. We are working with something around 82 plus organic food processed products are there. They are already on the shelves in major towns in across Karnataka, and even we are supplying to Rajasthan and then Udaipur and Pune also. So, apart from that, we deal in the bulk marketing segment also. So this is the whole of business aspect, what we are doing in Graam Chetana. And the model which we approached to evolve these FPOs is a sort of unconventional thing. Generally, organizing FPO means people go down from organizing the farmer groups and then collectivizing them, then registration and other things. So we went from the other way around. So we chose particularly to approach the issue from marketing angle. So we started buying from the farmers and then selling the commodities, be it any other grains. We are working with 16 different varieties of crops, apart from livestock and then dairy products. So for this agricultural crops, it's organic. Later on we entered into organic field. So we learned that there are so many issues that are hunting the farmers, and that's so when we try to improvise those systems in a pilot scale, we got a lot of response from farmers. And that made us, our lives, very easy to organize the FPOs. That's how we boiled down to organizing the FPOs. And that's how, and then even the standard livelihood models, approach to the livelihood models, the standard one is the basic one, LPS, IDS, and then on that livelihood triad. So we try to prioritize our approaches there. So there, our priority was access to the markets. We found that is the best thing which will enable farmers and then lure the farmers to organize themselves in a better way. And then the second priority was the access to the finance. Through microfinance we tried to help them. Third, of course, institutional development services, organizing them into FPOs, and then providing the inputs. So in my opinion, in our learnings for the last 4 years with the FPOs, it has been the provision of inputs is not on priority basis, because people have got access to many of the sources and they know how to produce and so many things. So that is their last priority. Their first priority is marketing. So I think it's the way of approach towards the livelihood model that drives the institutionalization of the farming communities for their benefit. This is all. Thank you.
Thank you, and good afternoon to all of you. I start with this. Anil and I came to this room quite early before the start of the session. There was no one, and we were talking to each other that, you know, it's the afternoon session and we are going to talk about rural livelihood, which is such a non-glamorous thing. So how many people do you think would be coming? He said, let's see, I mean, we don't know. And here you are, you have a packed house kind of thing. So thank you very much for coming down here and trying to spoil your lunchtime or you know, after lunchtime. Now coming back to the things that we have been trying to do in Dholpur, which is the Chambal River Basin, if you heard of it. I've been working in that place for last 17 years, and that's the place I started my career. And the methodology for us has been to mobilize the women into small groups at the grassroots level, at the village level, and trying to form their institutions. So we call them women institutions, whether you call them foundations, you call them associations, you call them cooperatives, you call them producer companies, depending on the context you are talking about. But these are the institutions we have been able to promote. And these institutions are the ones which decide what exactly they want to do in their own context. So, for example, in our context, because it's primarily rural setups and it's hardcore rural area I'm talking about. So in last 17 years or so, we have been able to mobilize around 62,000 women into 15 such cooperatives and one producer company. I'll come to that. And all these cooperatives are not only dealing with the finances, but also dealing with enhancing the production of agriculture, livestock, small ruminants like sheep and goats and fisheries, depending on the context, of course. You know, not all cooperatives are doing the same thing. At the same time, they have formed one institution of institution at the district level, which is the producer company, usually called FPOs in Indian parlance. And that producer company is the one which is adding value to all the products and selling it in the market, in Delhi market. So as of now, what we are doing is that what is the demand in the market that's being produced in the field conditions. And these women have come out with their own brand, which is called Kadori brand. So kadorifresh.com is also on the website there. They have it. They are, you know, competing with the well-established brands of Amul and, you know, Mother Dairy. So you can find their products into hyper-city malls in Delhi. So what I'm trying to share with you is that in most of the cases where NGOs have been promoting all these institutions, we are more into production enhancement but not into the market thing. Here we are talking about the market thing first. So what is it that can be sold in the market so that the farmers can have more remunerative prices for their produce? So in that way, it's a little different. We have had challenges, and I'm also not saying that it took for 17 years for us to reach to that level. You have to spend that much time to newer places. It has been converted to some kind of science these days, because I have seen in different places where we are. I mean, it's not us that, let me just cut myself. It's the women themselves who are multiplying themselves into different institutions. And the methodology is that they form small groups of 3 to 5 community resource leaders. And they go to newer villages and newer places. Not only outside Dhaulpur within Rajasthan, but now they are going to West Africa as well. So they are, you know, kind of sharing their experiences how mobilization can be done in a faster way, and it's the people to people learning, not a learning from me to the people. So in that way, it has been a different experience for all of us. I'll share while we go along more. So thank you very much again.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Arvind Malik. My organization name is Udyogini. Udyogini means a woman entrepreneur. So a woman who is doing its own enterprise called Udyogini in its literal meaning. So we are a 25 years old not-for-profit organization. We began with a training curriculum called business management training. And we thought that by doing that or exposing women by this training curriculum, it will trigger a sense of business in them, which actually it did. But in order to sustain businesses, as my other colleague also said, you need a lot of other support. You need finance, you need market, you need quality. So there are many aspects that you need to cover and handle. So Udyogini, after its first phase, kind of emerged as a BDS organization where different business services are given to women. Now, when we are saying women, these are rural women, and the context is that they're doing all sorts of things in their household. They're taking care of their children, household. So in a way, they're already burdened. So they have two, three hour window. But the idea is that unless they get extra income, they are not going to become independent. So the whole central idea is to raise their income so that they they get a space which they deserve. So Udyogini has been in this work since 25 years. Especially two approach we have picked up. One is to pick up a product. So when I'm saying a product, for example, let's just say cashew. You know, cashew can be a product where women are growing or are growing cashew nuts actually. So then we look at the whole chain and see if the women's income can be increased in this entire value chain. What she can do, what information she doesn't have, for example. So there are a lot of knowledge gathered, before even beginning on that product. So the product actually then takes care of many producers who are in that product producing it, knowing whether they actually produce well, they produce enough, or there is a POP which can work in order to maximize their production. So there is a production level, then there is an aggregation kind of work, and then obviously the marketing. So this entire operation, you have producers who are there to produce more and increase their income. Then there are different entrepreneurs which are created in order to aggregate the produce and then taking it to the market. So this is one approach where large numbers are covered, large numbers of women are approached. The second approach is micro-enterprise approach, which is self-employment, we call it. Basically, individual women are given skill and entrepreneurship training, and they are free to choose what they want to do. And in that, then they are handled for a year, and then they become on their own. They sustain their tiny, very small businesses that they think they can do. So this is a second approach. That's how we empower women. Thank you.
Actually, I call a system of root intensification as Sri Vidhi. Sri means soup, and Sri is way of living life. Either this is for human being or for plants. Way of life, the way nature wants, no? And not the way educated people want. So this methodology is called Sri Vidhi, yani Sub Vidhi. The way when Sri is added to a name, it adds respect to the human being. No? So the methodology itself is respectful, and it's God's way of cultivation, you can say. In this, you see, natural resources are declining. Holding per capita is getting reduced day by day. Input-based agriculture has led to suicides by lakhs of farmers. In India, no? You might have heard about Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, everywhere. So all these things we need to look at. Why this happened? That is why addressing problem at the roots. Unless foundation is strong, you cannot make building over that. No? When you promote input-based agriculture, no, the people, the farming community who do not have purchasing power, they are not able to make access to that. So from that, we change to knowledge-based agriculture. From input-based to knowledge-based. From per unit area, how can we get more? So if you see the assumptions behind the Green Revolution, which came in the 60s in India, that enhanced production, but that the production, the cost of production was very costly, no? Because we are seeing affairs are there at the hospitals, no? And the diseases among 1980, 60 to 70% households became diseased. So the assumptions behind the Green Revolution was a high input, high production. If one is giving 40 kg of urea, I will give 80 kg of urea in the same piece of land, no? To get more production. The second assumption was no guarantee of sustainability. You see, the indications started coming just 25-30 years hence that. The third assumption behind that, the poorer did not penetrate in the poorest pocket. No? Because the poorest community, they do not have the purchasing power to access the input-based agriculture. That is why the poor remained poor for a long time. So, in this SRI, it is just opposite. Low inputs, no? Where farmers were using 50 kg per acre paddy, they started using only 2 kg paddy. You see, where farmers were using 54 to 81 kg per acre wheat, they started using 10 kg wheat. The farmers who are getting 16 quintals to 30 quintals per hectare of paddy yield, they started getting 70 quintals on an average, and many got more than 100 quintals, 150 quintals per hectare. So this is the change. Farmers who were not able to feed their family for 3 months, they started feeding their family for the whole year. The villages were, this was piloted, the project was piloted. And this also drew much attention to the, and it brings sustainability. No? The carrying capacity of land, water and resources keeps intact for the coming generation. No? At the same time, you double the yield. No? At least 50% to 150% in various crops. Yield is enhanced. So per unit area you get more with less. This is what Srividhi is. It took a lot of attention from the government agencies when this was first piloted there. And the state government of Bihar, they adopted this fully. No, it is going on in their processes. Even under central government also, National Food Security Mission, Government of India, they adopted this. Demonstrations. And there is one national consortium of SRI is created at there. Indian Agricultural Research Institute and all the scientific community, we are opposed to me. Now they have started appreciating this. So the one farmer from our project was called by Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi. And with the instruction of farmer, with the association of that farmer, IARI New Delhi carried experiment for continuously 3 years to test its validity. And package of practices was discussed among all the scientists. I was also there. And now they have come up with a paper that no, this is climate resilient, this gives higher yield, it incurs low inputs. So these are various things. I am doing many other things also, but my work mainly is not about this system of root intensification. So again also, I see that the human being and plants are more different. How do we respect plants in that? If you see the principles of SRI, start respecting plants, then plants will start respecting you. So when you start respecting plants, if a child falls from a mother's lap, she starts crying. But when you throw these seedlings, it doesn't affect you. You do not care for the children of the plants. This is the problem. But when you start respecting other beings also on this earth created by the nature, they start respecting us also. They start giving more return. This is what SRI is all about. In that principles, we use locally prepared fertilizers, you can use that. Locally prepared pesticides, you can use. And you can run the feeders also. So all those principles are integrated into this. This is one area which is spreaded. The other area is spreaded. I have created local cadres. Nearly 1056 poor farmers, mostly women, trained by us, are being called by several state governments of India to train their farmers on these innovations. No? So this way it is spreading. I started with just 128 farmers. So directly we work only with 52,000 farmers, but non-directly 16 lakh farmers it reached. No? Government reported. So that way it is growing, and all these local cadres are being called by several agencies across India, and also Mexico, Guatemala and other countries, they have invited our women to train their farmers. No? So the people across the world who were opposed to system of root intensification, the opposing scientists, a delegation of opposing scientists, they visited India and they visited our fields. Abruptly they went to 23 of the villages, of total 700 villages there. And after coming to that, after 3-4 days, they also provided me an international certificate for that. And they told me publicly that I was opposed to you when I did not visit this project. So I now appreciate the methodology. So this way it is just gaining ground across the world, and 72 countries, you know, gradually, they are into this. I mean, they are at some aspects they are doing others.
Thank you, sir. So before we come and take the public questions and all, we would like to come and go a little more deeper and come and dive into the businesses. Dr. Athani ji, you said three things are priorities: access to market, access to finance, and welcome and institutional building. So these are three in the very different verticals, and they are three different volumes. So as a startup or as a business woman, what's your welcome and experience of welcome and balancing or prioritizing welcome, and how do you really implement our business?
Yeah. Basically, our premise was that farmers have traditional and then very strong knowledge base on their own, because they have been doing agriculture for the past generations together. And the major issues that are haunting the farming community nowadays are associated with the supply chain. So these village level aggregators, then commission agents, and then ultimately, by the time it reaches to the consumer, now we all of us know only about 40% of that consumer is getting passed on to 35-40% passed on to the farmers. So the only way out was to streamline the supply chain. So that is where my major focus was on, and then meantime with the help of Deshpande Foundation to come up with the pilot in Ramdur area, that helped us a lot. Then we could learn most of the things, many of the things in 1 year of pilot. And the beginning, my target to aggregate the commodities was about 50 tons for the entire year for the rare and marginal crops like horseradish, mutki, then teal and other things. So we were not into the major crops also. But later on, we started working on that, and then my team got confidence. And then just about 3 years back, from 50 tons, this year we have already crossed 1,000 tons of aggregation within 3 years. So now we work with 16 commodities through the farmers groups. Now we are in 285 villages, working with 285 farmer groups, consisting of 5 to 15 farmers. And all are under certification process. 1,300 farmers are already certified as Arvind. And the main mantra here for our model to take off so fast was to was that we approached the issue from marketing angle, and I still feel, be it in crops, livestock or any other commodities, marketing has been the major issue for anyone. Now actually we are coming up with different finance, microfinance models, supported by microgram. We invested nearly about 8 crore rupees only in sheep and goat in the agricultural value chains, lending to the farmers groups. That is another thing. Now we have come up with reaching out to the women entrepreneurs, micro entrepreneurs connected with the farming sector. So we have already reached 14,000 women across our working areas in three districts of Maharashtra. The issue there was again the market. Most of the 90% of the women micro entrepreneurs, they fail. They tend to fail. That's what is our study says, because of the lack of marketing presence. So we started creating aggregation centers. With the help of the UNDP, we have set up 10 aggregation centers now, which are again managed by the community caterers. We have developed 150 women, trained women, who are trained to motivate these women micro entrepreneurs, train them properly, and then buy back the commodities, how to fix the prices, how to manage the procurement and other things. So all these things, groundwork has happened, and because of that, sudden scale up was possible. So we never attempted to increase the input or productivity of the farmers. The moment we saw 8 to 12% higher price than the markets, that is our findings, we have been able to give them 8 to 12%, which is a big money for them, very big money. And enthused by that, they started cultivating millets, multiple crops, and earlier they were doing only this commercial crops, monocropping. Now they have shifted to multiple cropping. So automatically the sustainability angle, it takes care. So it is not exaggerating to say that market determines what the farmers or producers should produce. Not what I like to produce and then they take it to market. Other way around, it won't work. So market is the prime determining factor, and that is where most of our development sector partners, we fail to appreciate markets and we fear the market forces. But actually there is meaning in that, and then if my learning has been that we should first work with the market, tend to sell our product producers, and then work with the farmers. That then the only rate of success will be very high.
And so in 2016 I started working in the rural sector basically. One thing that I have realized is this, there are too many people doing the same thing multiple times. If I talk about in the area that I am working in organic farming, so I am also trying to create a market, you also trying to create a market, you also trying to create a market. And all of us need money, all of us need capital expenditures, all of money need lots of resources. The question is that if all of us are connected in some way, why isn't that we are collaborating and rather than creating lots of brands, we create just one brand? And second thing is that rather than supplying to Delhi, to Bangalore, to Hyderabad, to Calcutta, why don't we supply in Kanpur, Jaipur, to Varanasi, to Lucknow? The number of food miles is less if we start creating the market. Because somehow, I don't know why, but the organic produce is seen as a very premium product. You have to sell out lots of money to pay just kg of wheat flow, which is not exactly the case. So that's my question, that why isn't it happening? Lots of people have been doing lots of things, why isn't this happening? Thank you.
The aspects of the Deshpande Foundation or even NABARD is trying to federate the FPOs and even the UNDP's mission. So everyone is making their own contributions and asking FPOs whether we can collaborate in some other. There are many issues which need to be, which we need to sit together and then sort out the issues. So market, the primarily being access to markets, products being overlap, and then whose product we have to purchase and what quantity. All those things are going on now. I think definitely that unified brand again is an issue, even for me. I have struggled for the last 3 years to build that Simply Sattvic brand. We have invested a lot of money on that. Building logo itself to popularizing the things. Now to amalgamate that brand into a different brand, it hurts. Actually, we are some sort of connection is there between our heart and then that logo. So there are many issues, and I think by the end of this year, we should, at least in North Karnataka area, be able to federate all our FPOs and then take it into a unified brand and then try and approach the markets. Because each FPO has got their own experiences with the markets. So that's the strength here.
Our experience has been that whatever product you take, there is already a market. We need to little bit understand it, study it, that how the whole thing, who are the players, how are they working in this chain, and then try and see if producer can maximize and how they can maximize. So there is a little bit this study part of here. For example, in tomato that we have done in Udaipur, we realized that they were not aggregating it rightly and timely. So those are the things that we built in, and then obviously their prices went up. Also, you know, there is a capacity issue. So as far as they can go, otherwise we thought, I mean, we now thinking that further away markets, the market that, you know, we generally talking about, you need a specialized agency. Like even in milk, unless Rumur came in, we couldn't do it. So the Rumur came with very specialized you know, operation to do it, and whatever, you know, they could do later on. So the each product has its own uniqueness to study, and then to see whether what is the capacity level of our producer, especially when we deal with. So then that's how you can decide how much you can maximize and which market to cater to.
Actually, there has been development at the government of India level also addressing these problems. So earlier, this organic certification was only at Ghaziabad. So now government has started extending this to the states. In every state capital, there is one branch of Ghaziabad has been opened by government of India, and from there farmers can be linked. And now farmers can easily access those things at the government level. Also, there is one program running at the government of India level. One organization is called Safe Harvest. And Safe Harvest, if you have a producer organization, like many people have, and if you are promoting organic things in grains, as of now in vegetable they have not yet done. So you can link that to Safe Harvest for marketing. The producer organization can have MOU with the Safe Harvest, and they can sell their produce there if they are promoting this. Also, the way in Hyderabad, Safe Harvest has created that if you put the samples, 98 compounds will be judged whether you have used chemicals or not in your product while growing the crops. So that systematic scientific checking, that machine has been installed in Hyderabad. If similar machine is also installed in Karnataka, any organization or under Deshpande Foundation, I am also partnered with Deshpande Foundation since last year. So this can be integrated. So at national level, we are a resource agency for production purposes. How do you enhance the productivity? How do you go for organic cultivation? How do you apply the principles of SRI? At the same time, for marketing, Safe Harvest is there. So, and CSA and PRAN are resources for the enhancing. So other organizations can also link to that.
So should we really switch to growing it organically, because I will not have a market for it, and this is from smaller towns. I mean, not necessarily does every farmer want their goods to be taken to larger towns which have the capacity to buy more expensive vegetables which are organic.
Maybe you should take a lot of questions and then answer correctly.
Yeah. How do we deal with that, basically?
Yeah. Other questions?
Input based
to knowledge base. You know, a doubling farmer's income goal necessarily, you know, implies that most of it again will be input based agriculture. So if everything from the top itself is coming in that direction, if government is putting money, policy, you know, to, you know, just augment the supply and not provide the rest of the market. So as experts on the field, what do you think? How achievable is this just a goal? Or even if we not reach the doubling goal, where can we reach with just a goal like this?
Actually, productivity means both agriculture, livestock, or even the aquaculture, whatever is possible in the same piece of land. So to increase the sustainability and then the flow of income, there are many methods. It need not be just to going for addition of fertilizer and then do the cropping system or all. It is the integration of everything. That is one. Because I was one of the member for these challenges in Karnataka, especially in Bagalkot district. So district level committee members, I am happy. Just to suggest how best we can integrate the systems and then increase the farmers' income. Things are going on like that. And regarding madam, your question, I don't see any logic in saying that organic producers have to shell down more money to buy at the consumer end. Actually, it is the other way around. For organic agriculture, the cost of input is nearly 25% of that of the chemical agriculture. So there should not be any reason why they should be charged more, excepting in the initial phases, as I experienced, to encourage these sorts of sustainable agriculture and to drift them or take them away from their chemical agriculture, we need to incentivize their prices. So that is a trick what we did in Bagalkot, in our working area. And once they start getting better prices for their price compared to the market prices, even say about 8 to 10%, and transparency in marketing buying systems from us, that encouraged them. So next year, they said, sir, next year also we'll support you. I laid down the condition. If you go in for only for organic cultivation, I'll buy from you, paying you extra money. Otherwise, no. Then automatically that pressurized them. Then they requested us to, you know, train them. Training also we do not believe. You know, proper classroom training. So we took them to exposure units. That's how we started, you know, converting them to organic. Only to that extent. And then another cost factor in this organic supply chain is the low volumes. In general commodities, the volumes are very high. So the cost of transportation, handling cost will be very less per unit of the grains. Here the volumes are lesser. That is why a little bit more cost we have to pay. That is not the, if it is through FPO, direct selling to the consumer, either through website or these things, the things are cheaper for the consumer. That's what we are experimenting now. If we have to give it to the retailers in the metro cities, then they simply ask for 35 to 40% margin on selling. So look at the dynamics in marketing. So then we cannot also go on opening, setting up retail shop in every locality in the urban areas and then start selling directly. There are some limitations. I think in the times to come, once the production of volume of organic producers improves, definitely prices should come down even at the retails. And that's the reason we are also on the run to start our own vehicle everywhere, including Balu, where our own processing facilities are. And even in Hubli, places like Hubli, people tend to, you know, incentivize consumers also. For example, Dharwad organic person who is here is Mr. Deshpande. He himself is an undergraduate. He is having 3 retail outlets, one in Belgaum, Hubli, and then in Dharwad. He is attending this seminar. So, actually, he is offering so many things to the consumers, you know, incentivizing them, discounts, offering discounts, undergoing his own commission basis. So, that way, in places like smaller places like Hubli and Dharwad also, people are a bit hesitant. Bangalore, the paying capacity is more, that's why they tend to charge more. Whereas here, that doesn't work. So, it's all on the market give and take mechanisms that the prices are varying for the organic food products. Definitely, it will be streamlined in short time. Same case with the vegetables also.
But one has to see the kind of investment which is needed for the smallholders. Because you have to invest into the land development, the irrigation facilities like the pond construction which is being done at the Deshpande Foundation, done by the different government programs as well. And plus the investment into the storage facilities like the godowns, where actually the smallholders do not have the access to these kind of facilities where they can hold up their produce for certain period of time, and then 2 or 3 months down the line they can sell it off in the market. And similarly for the organizations like the FPOs or the cooperatives, you need investment into the godowns, the cold chain, and the other infrastructure needed. Plus, I would say that we were hearing Mr. Biyani's telling that under one roof you have everything available, including the food articles. So why can't the big bazaars open up their doors to the FPOs and the cooperatives and let them enter with your own products? That will actually unleash the potential, which we are not thinking. We are still thinking about having retails here and there in small places, but not about in that scale. If that can be done, then for example, they are saying that 40% are the margin that they are asking for. If that can be reduced to say 25% or 20%, that money will actually go to the farmers. And that's where the inclusive policies make some difference in the lives of people. This is one thing that I wanted to respond to you.
So, this is very strange to me. I'm from the world of stock markets and investments, and I was asked to talk about something on livelihood to farms and farmers. So this, to me, the few sort of takeaways from there clearly was see what the market wants and then grow accordingly. And the other sort of theme that's been here, even we spoke about yoga yesterday, teaching that. And the one thing I've noticed, and actually I said this few decades ago, that Indians will discover yoga since it's packaged and canned and imported back from the US.
Right.
And we've done that. And same thing with organic farming and organic food. So the demand for organic food, the demand for yoga, is not coming from rural India as much as from urban India. And that was a hipster within urban India. So, it obviously will help a lot if you can collaborate with the futures, the big bazaars, if they open up the doors. I don't think they will, because corporate India is a man who speaks with forked tongue. We see that in the multiplex. Many multiplexes were launched in India with an undertaking that they would promote regional language films, and they did not do it. So I doubt that they would promote yours as much as you should try. I wish they do. But I doubt they do as much as that you'd like to see, if you will. The other sort of closing remark really is kind of linked to impact assessment. I'm from the corporate world. And I just want to say that when people are funding efforts that you all are doing, I hope they're not asking you what's the impact assessment. That's a corporate world transplant. And I just hope that they have the patience to see the impact over time, as opposed to 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, that gets to be the funding model. So, power to you, and just a round of applause to the panelists. Thank you.